Good morning. This is Dr. Karthic Babu Natarajan, consultant pain physician from the Synapse Pain and Spine Clinic in Chennai, India. We're going to be discussing a little bit about disc herniations, disc prolapse, sciatica, lower back pain with a little bit of radiating down the legs. Now, this is the entire human spine. Now, if you see here, the spine is made up of about 30 bones. Now, each of these bones has got a shock absorber between the bone, which we call as the disc. Now, this is normal. So, each bone has got a shock absorber. Normally, when we do a little bit of bouncing and jumping, this shock absorber will take the impact, thereby protecting the bone. Now, this is the front of the spine. This is the back of the spine. Immediately behind the spine, the yellow tube that you see is the spinal cord that comes all the way from the brain. So the spinal cord is essentially protected by the bones in the spine from any further injury. Now the spinal cord leaves nerves on either side. You have nerves coming from the spinal cord on the right side and on the left side. These nerves that come from the neck go to the hand. The nerves that come from the lower back go to the leg. Now, what happens in the disc prolapse is, the sort of injury that we see could be a fall, it could be lifting some heavy weight, or it could be a long travel. A lot of times patients who have disc prolapses or disc herniations do not recall what is the incident that caused the disc herniation, because initially they may not have pain. The pain develops subsequently over 5 days, 6 days, or after a week after the injury. So patients with disc herniation have back pain initially. After some time, this pain can radiate down the legs. Now this radiation down the legs could be starting from the lower back, going to the buttock, back of the thigh, back of the knee, calf muscle, all the way towards the toes. The disc herniation, what happens is, the disc gets squeezed out. When it gets squeezed out, it either touches or compresses the spinal cord or the spinal nerves. Whenever a nerve gets pinched, we call this a pinched nerve, the patients can have symptoms like pain. Sometimes they may have shock-like sensations. Sometimes they have tingling. This is the usual symptoms. So the nerves in the lower back go to the leg. So whenever they have a disc herniation, the common levels in which we see disc herniation are L4, L5, L5S1, L standing for lumbar. So whenever they have disc herniations in L4, L5, L5S1, the nerves that get pinched are L5 and S1. We have names for these nerves. So these nerves start in the lower back, buttock, back of the thigh, calf muscle, all the way to the legs. So patients with the disc herniation can have symptoms on one leg or both legs. So they have predominantly pain. Pain sometimes is radiating to the legs. Along with that, they may have some shock or tingling sensation. They feel as if the nerve is being pulled. Now these symptoms, which we call as sciatica, that is back pain radiating to the leg, need not be there at all times. Some patients can have change of symptoms during the day, during the duration of the day. Sometimes the symptoms can change along with change in posture. So when you bend forward, the pain may be worse. When you're standing straight, the pain may be less. When you're lying down, the pain will be almost nil. So it can change with position. Second thing is, if the nerve pinching becomes a little bit more, along with the pain and the tingling, these patients will also have some numbness. Occasionally, you may feel that the foot or the calf muscle is becoming numb. So numbness can be part of the sciatica symptoms. If the nerve gets compressed completely severely, so the spinal cord is getting pinched more severely, the nerves are getting pinched more severely, these group of patients, we have a severe disease, those group of patients will not be able to move the feet. So when patients are not able to move the feet, that means the compression is a little bit more. These patients in severe cases may not be able to control your urine and your motion. So patients with severe spinal cord stenosis will not be able to control their urine. They'll not be able to control their motion. So this is something which we take very seriously. But majority of patients with disc herniations, with small disc herniations or disc bulges that we call it, common levels being L4, L5, S1, have a bit of pain radiating to the posterior, the back of the thigh, a bit in the calf muscle, sometimes in the foot. Now, when somebody comes with a disc herniation, your doctor will assess you. He will do a good clinical examination, and then he may ask you to do an X-ray. Sometimes we may ask you to do a lumbar spine MRI. So the purpose of doing an lumbar spine MRI is to confirm if there is a disc herniation. If so, at what level, how much prolapse is there, and how much these nerves are getting compressed. So depending on the X-ray and MRI findings, we take a call deciding how much the disc herniation is, how severe it is, and how we should treat. If you see the treatment of disc herniation, broadly we divide them into three categories. So the first thing is the conservative management. So conservative management means patients with disc herniation need to do some lifestyle changes. So the common lifestyle changes that we describe, that we suggest to patients with disc herniation, are a little bit careful when you have to lift weights. Avoid bending down and lifting weights. If at all you have to lift weights with a disc herniation, make sure you don't bend your backs. Keep your back straight, bend your knees, go down, get the weight as close as possible, and then straighten up. So essentially, instead of bending the back, keep the back straight, bend the knees, go down and pick it up. It's ideal that patients with disc herniations do not lift weights. Second thing is, when you travel as much as possible by a car which is or a vehicle which is not very jerky. Try to avoid two-wheelers and three-wheelers. Car, bus, train, plane is fine. Two-wheelers, three-wheelers, try to avoid, because a jerky travel will put more strain on the back. Third thing that we advise is, at home, make sure you have a reasonably firm bed mattress. A firm or a hard bed mattress is ideal. We suggest a medium-sized pillow, which is about 3 to 4 inches. So these are the lifestyle changes that we want patients with disc prolapse to be on. Along with that, a regular amount of walking, physical activity is encouraged. Make sure you have a good chair in your workplace. Once this is done, patients with disc herniation with radiating pain, we start them on some medicine, which could be some basic painkillers, along with nerve-related nerve medicine. So the common nerve medicines that we use are pregabalins and the gabapentins, which commonly we describe. So along with the medicine and the exercise, we also suggest what is called as physical therapy. Physical therapy is, we teach the patients some gentle back strengthening exercises. So the patients are taught the exercises by the physiotherapist. They learn it once or twice and do it at home. So conservative management for disc herniation mainly involves lifestyle changes, gentle exercises at home, basic pain medicine. A majority of patients with disc herniation with conservative management will settle down completely. After that, they continue the lifestyle changes and exercises at home, and it's possible that disc herniations resolve completely after a period of time. Now, there are a group of patients who don't settle down with conservative management. These are the patients who we put in the moderate category. So in this group of patients, where you have tried the medicine, you have tried a bit of exercise, you have done the lifestyle changes, but in spite of this, you are having radiating pain. Sometimes patients have pain and tingling radiating down the leg. So these are the group of patients who are good for pain injections. So we call this pain intervention. So what we do is, we take these patients to a procedure room, see where these nerves are getting pinched. Under X-ray guidance, we put injections near where these nerves are getting pinched. So we can inject around the nerve that is getting pinched and relieve these patients of radiating pain. Now, the procedure that I'm talking about is something which is called as a selective nerve root injection. A transforaminal nerve root injection or a selective nerve root injection is a pain procedure which is done in a procedure room or in a OT. This procedure is done under X-ray or fluoroscopic guidance. This is usually done under local anesthesia or IV sedation, and this is a day care procedure. So you have to come to the procedure room, we put you face down, we clean the back, we give a bit of local anesthesia, put these injections wherever the nerves are getting pinched, and then if it is involving both sides, we do these injections on both sides, and the procedure is about a half an hour procedure. Very effective treatment for patients with disc herniations causing nerve impingement with radiating pain down the leg. So the procedure is about 45 minutes. Post procedure, we keep you in observation in the hospital for about 1 or 2 hours, and then you can go home that day. You can pretty much start all normal activities after the next day. After a couple of days, your doctor or pain physician will check you, and then we will start you on the exercise regime, which the physiotherapist will teach you. You learn it, start doing it at home regularly, along with some basic medication. So for the conservative management, I told you what are the things. The patients who are not responding to conservative management, who still have pain in spite of taking medicines, are good candidates for pain procedures, which is selective nerve root injection or transforaminal nerve root injection, which are very safe and effective procedures, and they are done on a day care basis under local anesthesia or IV sedation. If you do the lifestyle changes and the exercises continuously, you will have long-term relief with these injections. Now, we also have a group of patients where the disc herniation is very severe. These group of patients have numbness in the leg. These patients also have motor weakness, is what we call as difficulty in moving the foot. Some patients have difficulty in controlling urine. Some patients have difficulty in controlling motion. So these are the severe category in disc herniation. This group of patients are good candidates for surgical decompression. So we have to give general anesthesia, go inside, remove what is compressing on the spinal cord, cut it off, and then come out. We may just do a basic procedure like a discectomy or a microdiscectomy. Sometimes we also go and do what is called as a stabilization procedure, where you think after the surgery there may be a bit of instability. So this is something we call as a T-lift or a P-lift. We put some pedicle screws and then rods and fix the whole system so that it doesn't herniate again. So you have, I broadly describe three treatments for disc herniation. One is conservative management, which is lifestyle changes, medicines, gentle exercises. Second one, for moderate patients who have mainly pain and tingling down the leg. This group of patients, I said, are good candidates for pain injections called selective nerve root injections. There is also an option for this group of patients, which we call as an endoscopic spine surgery, where we go in through a keyhole, remove what is protruding, and then bring out that tissue. Lastly, in very severe category, where they have complete numbness, where they have difficulty in moving the feet, in this group of patients, we do open spine surgery, and we also do stabilization of the spine. Now, we also have a group of patients who are unfit for surgery or who are unwilling for surgeries. I know a group of patients who say, whatever it is, I don't want to undergo a spine surgery. So in this group of patients, again, we try either conservative management or pain injections. Now the pain injections, the advantage with this pain injection is, first thing is, it's a day care procedure. You come, get it on the day. So the procedure is about half an hour, 45 minutes. Another 1 hour of observation, so you're out of the hospital by about 2 to 3 hours, one. Second is, it doesn't require general anesthesia. It's done under local anesthesia, maybe a bit of sedation. Third is, you can go back to work fast. So we are looking at return to work on the second or maybe on the next day itself. And lastly, patients who are either of very elderly population or who are high risk for surgery are good candidates for pain injections. And patients who want to avoid spine surgery or who want to avoid neck or lumbar spine surgeries can also consider pain injections. So pain injections are a very effective and safe way of treating patients with disc herniation Specifics, I've given you a guideline. Specifics, you have to discuss with your pain doctor, if required, with a spine surgeon as well, and then take a call as to what is the effective treatment for you, and then take a call accordingly. But disc herniation is not a very difficult to treat. If you find your correct doctor, you should be able to completely relieve yourself of radiating back pain and radiating pain down the leg with good treatment. So good luck to all of you who are watching with disc herniation. Thank you.